Dear students, welcome to our fluid mechanics subject. So in this class we will see about unit 1 fluid statics. So in this chapter fluid statics we will discuss about fluid pressure, Pascal's law and measurement of pressure in a pipe using manometers. There are different types of manometers is there. After that, hydrostatic pressure in a horizontal, vertical and inclined surfaces. And the last one, buoyancy and stability of floating bodies. So the first subject chapter is fluid statics, Pascal's law. So first we will discuss about already fluid statics. What is meant by fluid statics? So fluid statics is the branch of fluid mechanics that studies incompressible fluids at rest. So I already told last class, the best example for fluids at rest is water stored in a water tank. That is the best example. So in that water tank there is no external forces acting. The fluid is under rest. That is called that study of that fluid at rest condition is called fluid statics. So in this fluid statics we have to discuss first Pascal's law. What is meant by Pascal's law? So the Pascal's law is nothing but pressure applied at any point of a fluid in a enclosed container is transmitted without loss to all other parts of the fluid. That means the pressure is equally distributed in the all the three directions. So an external force applied on the surface in a enclosed body, in that liquid the liquid pressure is increases. This increase in liquid pressure is transmitted equally in all directions and to the walls of the container in which it is filled. So this result is called Pascal's law. Okay, so here you can see there are this is a fluid element, a triangular element. So in a vertical direction there will be a px forces there, and then in horizontal direction there is a py forces there, and in a inclined portion there will be a pz forces there. Okay, so all the forces are acting normal to the plane. So as per Pascal's law, this all the pressure are equal in all the direction. So let us see with an example. So take a rubber ball. Okay, so in the rubber ball filled with a liquid, for example water. So make a hole. Okay, make a hole around 10 holes. For example, 10 holes, a small hole in that rubber ball. Okay, now what you do, using your finger you applied a external force. Okay, you compress the ball. Now what you can see, so the water is inside water, due to the external pressure the inside water will come out in all the direction equally. So that is the Pascal's law verification. So the pressure applied in one point, so here this is the point we are applying, using our finger we are applying a pressure force. Okay, the pressure applied in one point of liquid transmits equally in all directions. So this is the verification of the Pascal's law. So in our day to day life, we can see many instruments, many equipments are working as per this Pascal's law. So for example, a toothpaste, you can take a toothpaste, hydraulic brake system, hydraulic jack, hydraulic press, hydraulic machines. So these are all the equipments and instruments are working as per Pascal's law. Now you can see these pictures. Here there are two vertical column is there. So in this vertical column, a incompressible fluid or oil is filled. Incompressible fluid is filled. Okay. So you know about a carbide. So now, how to lift this car in a simplest way? By applying a small force in this piston. So automatically the pressure, as per Pascal's law, the pressure is distributed equally in all the liquids. So within a minimum force, automatically this piston will raises. Okay, so this is the best, this hydraulic machines working as per Pascal's law. And toothpaste, in toothpaste also we are applying force at the end. Okay, we are not applying at the we are not pressing the paste near the opener. We are applying our force, okay, through our finger at the end. So that force is equally transmitted in the toothpaste. And from the opener of the paste container, it will deliver. Okay. And this pressure measuring instrument, blood pressure measuring instrument. And this hydraulic lift. And this hydraulic jack. So these are all the best examples for the Pascal's law. Okay. So all the hydraulic machines are working under Pascal's law only. So next, another important law is hydrostatic law. What is meant by hydrostatic law? So you can see this container, it filled with water. Okay. So in this container, there are three holes are there. One is at the bottom, another one is at the top, and one more at middle. So if you fill with water, what you observe? So due to the high pressure from the bottommost hole, the liquid will come, it will travel very fast, and also the distance of the distance also very large. Okay, the throwing distance of the liquid also very large. If we come to at middle hole, compared to bottom, this throwing distance is somewhat very small because due to less pressure. And at the top, near the top of the hole, the throwing distance is very very less compared to other two liquid jets. Okay. So here pressure will be very very less. From this instrument, from this experiment, what you understand, if depth increases, depth of the liquid increases means pressure also increases. So for that only the dams are constructed in a trapezoidal shape. Okay. So at bottom, the width of the dam is huge. Okay, huge width compared to top. In top, very very small. Okay, but in bottom, the width is very very large, because if depth increases, that pressure, intensity of pressure also increases. So that is called hydrostatic law. So next important definitions under hydrostatic law is total pressure and center of pressure. So what is meant by total pressure and center of pressure? The total pressure is defined as the force exerted by a static liquid on a surface, either plane or curve, when the fluid comes in contact with the surface. This force is always normal to the surface. Okay. So suppose consider a solid body, a metal plate or wood plate, you can take. Okay. You immerse the plate in the water tank. Okay. So in the water tank, water is stagnated under static condition, at rest. Okay. You immerse the plate. So somehow the pressure is acting on the plate, normal to the plate. That means perpendicular to the surface of the plate. Okay. So that pressure is called total pressure. Okay. So if the plate is near the surface of the liquid, liquid means the pressure acting on the plate is very, very less. So if the plate is under submerged condition or up to a very long depth, means the pressure will be more. Okay. Because of the hydrostatic law, if depth increases, pressure also increases. Okay. So that is the reason. Next, what is my center of pressure? Center of pressure is defined as the point of application of the resultant pressure on the surface. Okay. So where the total pressure is acting, okay, on the particular solid body, that point. Okay, that is called center of pressure. Okay. So we can take center of pressure from the surface of the liquid. Okay. So like that, our center of gravity. So we know about the center of gravity. What is the center of gravity? So if you take a solid body, the entire weight of the mass of the entire mass of the body will concentrate on the one point. That is called center of gravity. Likewise, so the fluid exerts the pressure. That pressure will be concentrated on the a particular point. So the distance between that particular point, the total pressure acting point, to the surface of the water, the distance is called center of pressure. So there are four important conditions is there, okay, under total pressure and center of pressure category. The first one is that solid plate, a solid body, is vertically immersed. Okay, it is vertically immersed. Suppose you can take this irregular solid body. The h bar is the distance between the center of gravity to the surface, free surface of the liquid. And h star is the point of application of total pressure, okay, to the free surface of the liquid. So it is called the center of pressure. Okay. So AB is the height of the solid body. So the center of pressure under total pressure and center of pressure formula is rho g A into h bar. Rho g A into h bar. Rho is the density of the liquid and g is the acceleration due to gravity and A is the area of the plate and h bar is the distance between the center of gravity to the free surface of the liquid. So if you can take water, means you know that the density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube. And g, acceleration due to gravity, is 9.81 meter per second square. The force will be in newton. Okay, the unit is newton. This is the total pressure. And center of pressure. Center of pressure formula is Ig plus H bar divided by A H bar. Okay, actually this is the formula I G plus A into H square bar divided by A into H bar. So here one A H square, one A H bar, and bottom one A H bar get cancelled. So finally, the formula is I G divided by A H bar plus H bar. So IG is the moment of inertia of area about an axis passing through the CG of the solid body to the free surface of the liquid. Okay, so moment of inertia. So this is the vertically immersed surface. So next, horizontal immersed surface. So consider the plate is very very thin plate. The thickness is negligible means. So both the center of gravity point and center of pressure point both lies in a same point. Okay, center of gravity as well as center of pressure point. Okay, so therefore H bar and H star both are equal. So under this condition, F is equal to rho g A into H bar, same formula, and H bar equal to H star. Both center of pressure and center of gravity both lies in the same point. Okay. So in case of a plate is in inclined manner. So this is the inclined plate. Okay. This dark line is the inclined plate thickness, and this is the angle of the inclination. So here H bar and H stars are different. Okay. So the total pressure formula is same, F is equal to rho into g into A into H bar, but H star, so due to this inclination we introduce one term, sin square theta. So IG sin square theta divided by A into H bar plus H bar. So theta is the angle of the inclination of the solid body, and A is the area of the plate, and H bar is the center of gravity. You can see here, this is the G, center of gravity point to the here. Okay, here is the center of gravity point to the free surface of the liquid. Okay, this is the inclined immersed surface. So one more surface is there, that is curved surface, but as per your syllabus it is not there. Okay, fluid pressure. What is meant by pressure generally? So pressure may be defined as the force exerted by a fluid per unit area, like stress. So what is by stress in strength of material? So force, internal resisting force per unit area. So same way, in case of solid mechanics or strength of material, it is called stress. So same thing in fluid mechanics, it is called pressure. Okay. So it may be called as intensity of pressure. Sometimes it is called intensity of pressure. Okay. So why we need to calculate the pressure? Okay. So let us see. So when a surface is submerged in a fluid, forces developed on the surface due to the fluid. Okay. The determination of these forces is important. Here, forces means the pressure. Is important in the design of storage tanks, ships, dams, and other hydraulic structures. Okay, so the determination of pressure is required mainly design of tanks, design of pipes, okay, and the design of dams, ships, and other hydraulic structures, reservoirs, etc. Okay, for fluids at rest, we know that the force must be perpendicular. That means perpendicular means what? Normal to the surface. Okay, since there is no shearing stress present at rest, there is no shearing stress. So where shearing stress occurs? When the fluid is in motion, under motion only shear stress occurs. The pressure varies linearly with the depth. if the fluid is incompressible. Okay, so that we already seen in hydrostatic law. If depth increases, pressure also increases. Okay, so next topic is manometer. What is meant by manometer? So it is a device. Okay, it is an instrument, or it is called a device, which is used to measure the pressure of a liquid at a point in a pipe. Okay, so mainly manometer is used for measuring the pressure in a pipe. So what are the classification of the manometer? So majorly, manometers are classified under two categories. First one is simple manometer, second one is differential manometer. So under simple manometer, again it is subdivided into three categories: piezometer, U-tube manometer, and single column manometer or micro manometer. So under differential manometer, that also divided into three categories: U-tube differential manometer, inverted U-tube differential manometer, and differential micro manometer. So in your syllabus, so here I highlighted in red color. That is only mentioned in your syllabus, fluid mechanics syllabus. So now we will see one by one. What is meant by piezometer? So piezometer is the simplest device to measure the pressure. So consider this is a pipe. So this is a pipe. Okay. So it is somewhat very long. Say assume a 3 meter length. This is a pipe. Suppose I want to measure at the middle of the pipe. So that point is called A. Okay. I want to measure at the middle of the pipe pressure. I need to measure pressure at the middle of the pipe. That point is A. Okay. So this pipe is connected in a tube. The tube is vertically held. Okay. That tube is called piezometer tube. Piezometer tube. So according to the pressure developed inside the pipe, the water level get increased in the piezometric tube. Okay, suppose that height is called h, means that pressure at a point is called, is the formula, from the formula it is rho into g into h. So what is in the rho? We know that it is density, and g is the acceleration due to gravity, and h is the height of the liquid. So we have to measure from the center point of the pipe to the free surface of the liquid in the tube. Okay, so the unit is newton per meter square. Unit is newton per meter square. So piezometer is one of the simplest form of manometer. Okay, so that manometer consists of a simple manometer is one which consists of a glass tube whose one end is connected, to a point where pressure is to be measured, and the other end is open to atmosphere. It should not be closed, it should be open to atmosphere. It can be used for measuring moderate pressures of liquids. Okay, so this instrument not suitable for high pressure liquids, only moderate pressure liquids. Next, U-tube manometer. So from the title we can understand it is in the shape of U. Okay, alphabet, English alphabet U shape. Okay, so the manometer is named so because it consists of a glass tube having the shape of the alphabet U. So one end is open to the atmosphere and the other end connected to a point at which pressure is to be measured. Okay, this is called U-tube manometer. So from this, this blue color is the heavy density liquid, say mercury. Okay, so this green color is light density liquid, say water. or some other oil, water, petrol, or some other oil. Okay. So the height h1 is nothing but the center of the pipe to the that one of the edge of the mercury, that is h1. H2 is the difference between the mercury height is called h2 in both the limb. So this is the left limb. Okay, this glass tube, one side, the vertical column is called limb. This left side is called a left limb and that right side is called a right limb. Okay, so this is called U tube manometer. So there are two different conditions. For gauge pressure, formula is different, and for vacuum pressure, formula is different. For gauge pressure, this is the formula, rho 2 GH2 minus rho 1 GH1. Okay, rho 2 GH2 and rho 1 GH1. Okay, so the H1 and H2 are mentioned here. Okay, so consider this is a datum line. From the datum line to the center point of the pipe is called H1, and H2 is this from the datum line, the height of the mercury. Okay, so it is H2. So rho one is the, what is rho one? Density of the light liquid, say water. Okay, rho two is the density of the heavy liquid. Okay, so how to find density? So specific gravity of the, if in the problem the specific gravity is given, means just multiply by the specific gravity into 1000. Okay, so we can find the density of the liquids. So this is for gauge pressure. And the vacuum pressure means, you can see the difference between gauge pressure and vacuum pressure height. So this is the H1 and this is the H2. This mercury, H1 is the liquid height and H2 is the mercury height. Difference in the mercury height. So for vacuum pressure, P is equal to minus rho 2 GH2 plus rho 1 GH1. Okay, this is formula for the vacuum pressure. Next come to single column manometer. Okay, single column manometer is one modified form of U tube manometer. Okay, so there will be a one reservoir. So here reservoir means a small sized tank is attached in the manometer with large cross sectional area, about 100 times as compared to the area of the glass tube. Okay, so we know that the area of the glass tube, that the limbs, okay, area. So compared to that glass tube, it is 100 times more. That reservoir tank is 100 times more. Okay, so one limb of the glass tube will be connected with the reservoir and another limb of glass tube will be open to atmosphere. Okay, so under this single column manometer, there are two basic types. One is vertical single column manometer, another one is inclined single column manometer. So what is the difference? Let us see. So this is the vertical single column manometer. So why it is called vertical single column manometer means, see, one of the limb, that means the right limb, is exactly held vertically. That means 90 degree. Okay, pure vertically it will be placed. So this is the reservoir. So this reservoir size is 100 times more than the area of the glass tube. Okay, suppose we want to pressure in a pipeline. Okay, at any point means this is the formula. A into H2 divided by capital A. This is small a, this is capital A. And rho 2 G minus rho 1 G plus H2 rho 2 G minus H1 rho 1 G. So A to what is small a and capital A? Okay, small a is the cross sectional area of the right limb. Okay, this cross sectional area, and capital A is the cross sectional area of the reservoir. So this is the reservoir, cross sectional area of the reservoir. Okay, and rho 1, rho 2, these are all the com, and h1, h2, I mentioned here. H1 is the reservoir, from the reservoir to the center point of the pipe height. And H2 is the difference in the mercury level. Okay, this is the formula for the vertical single column manometer. Next, come to inclined. So here only the right limb BC, not 90 degree. It was somewhat angle. It placed somewhat some angle. That angle is called alpha. Okay. So how to measure this height, H2 height? So H2 is, this is alpha, means this H2 height, this inclined length of the mercury level. Okay, from the datum line is L means. So the vertical height is from the datum line, H2 is L into sine alpha. Okay, so this is the opposite side. This is the angle alpha. This is the opposite side. So H2 is equal to L into sine alpha. Okay. So from this, formula is same. Only we have to change this H2. Instead of H2, we have to put L into sine alpha. Okay. So for both the condition, the formula is same. Only the difference is, instead of H2, we have to put L into sine alpha. That is the magic. That is the difference. So next, come to differential manometer. So, okay, so far we seen simple manometer. Now we can see differential manometer. Okay, so what is the differential manometer means? We can measure the pressure for two different liquids. Suppose here two pipes are carrying different liquids, means we can easily find the pressure difference. Okay. So, what is my differential manometer? Differential manometers are used to measure the difference of pressures between two points in a pipe. Okay, suppose this is one pipe and this is one pipe. Means we can measure the pressure difference. Okay, two points in a pipe are in two different pipes. Okay, so you can see here two pipes at different levels. Suppose this one pipe is different level, another pipe is different level. Okay, so the x is nothing but the mercury level to the center of the point, and y is also mercury level to the center of the point of one pipe under another pipe. And h is the difference in mercury level, means the pressure difference at A and B is equal to h into g into rho g minus rho 1 plus rho 2 g y minus rho 1 g x. Okay, rho 1 g x. So here, what is rho g? Suppose one pipe carries water, another pipe carries some other liquid, say oil. Means these densities are different. Okay, so rho 1 is the density in the pipe A and rho 2 is the density in the pipe B. Now rho g is the density of the mercury, density of the heavy liquid. Okay, so x and y are the sides. Okay, so now this at two different levels. So this formula applicable for two pipes are in different levels. One is upper and other one is lower. Suppose you can take these two pipes are in the same level. Okay, two pipes are in the same level. Okay, from the datum. So here xx is the datum line. Xx is the datum line. So under this condition, the formula is g into h into rho g minus rho 1. Okay, rho g minus rho 1. So this is the formula. So inverted U-tube differential manometer. Some case the U-tube manometers are under inverted condition. So this type of manometer is used when the difference between the densities of the two liquids is small. Okay. So this type of manometer is used when the difference between the densities. So here in one pipe, one type of liquid is there, another pipe, another liquid is there. The difference in density of liquid is very small, means we can use this type of inverted U-tube manometer. Okay. So the difference between the pressure is PE minus PP is equal to rho 1 GH1 minus rho 2 GH2 minus rho G into G into H. Here H1, H2 they mentioned, and H also they mentioned. So this is the formula. Okay. So far we seen pressure measuring equipments. Okay. So next we will move to buoyancy. So what is meant by buoyancy? So before understand the term buoyancy, first we have to understand the Archimedes principle. So you know about the scientist Archimedes. What is the Archimedes principle? So when your body is immersed fully or partially in a liquid or fluid, it experiences an upward force. Okay, it experiences some upward force that is equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by it. Okay, suppose if you take your water in a container. Okay, so you must have a solid body. You must have a solid body in the water. Okay, what happened? The water level get raises. So that solid body displaces the water. Okay, so that water weight, the displaced water weight is equal to the that upward force developed in the fluid. So this both are equal. So this is the Archimedes principle. And also the volume of the displaced water and the volume of the solid both are equal. Okay, suppose I want to know the some irregular shape volume. Suppose if you take a cube, we can easily measure the volume, that means length, breadth and depth. Okay, suppose if you want to know the irregular shape, a solid body having irregular shape, it is very difficult to measure the volume. So using this Archimedes principle, we can easily measure. Okay, the displaced water volumes, which is equal to the volume of the irregular shape body. Okay, so that upward force developed in the fluid is called buoyancy, buoyant force or buoyancy force. So buoyancy is an upward force exerted by a fluid on an immersed object in a gravity plane. In fluids, pressure increases with the depth. That is the hydrostatic law we already seen. Hence, when an object is immersed in a fluid, the pressure exerted on its bottom surface is higher than the pressure exerted on its top surface. This difference in the pressure leads to a net upward force, which opposes the gravity force and is equivalent to the weight of the fluid that would otherwise occupy the volume of the object, that is the displaced fluid. Okay, so now let us do one simple experiment. Take a solid body, the weight is 10 kg. Okay, in air. Okay, in air it is 10 kg. Okay, and this is the container filled with the 3/4 filled with the water or some other fluid or liquid. Okay, so now you immerse this 10 kg into the water. What happened? Now you can see what is the weight. It is around 6 kg. Okay, why the weight is reduced? In air it is 10 kg, but in water, same material, same solid body, when immersed in water, it shows only 6 kg. What is the difference? So 4 kg. What happened that 4 kg? So that 4 kg is the buoyant force. That 4 kg is the buoyant force. Okay, so due to this 10 kg of the solid body, the some of the water get displaced. See, you can see here, this is the dotted line indicates the original height. Okay, and due to this immersion of the 10 kg solid body, the water get raises. Okay, the rise of water weight is accurately matched with the difference in the weight. That means 4 kg. Okay, so the 4 kg of water displaced here. Okay, so this is not height. 4 kg is not height. This is the weight of the water displaced. So the same weight is called buoyant force weight. So the buoyant force is equal to the weight of the displaced water. So from this experiment, we can easily understand the buoyant force concept and the Archimedes principle. Next, come to stability of the floating bodies. How ships are floating? Okay, or any other air thermocol or some other floating material, how they float? Okay, so you can see the floating this diagram. This is a floating body, floating material. Okay, so we know that the entire weight of the solid body is concentrated on a single point, that is called a gravity, acceleration due to gravity. Okay, this is the G point. This will be, sorry, not acceleration due to gravity, it is center of gravity. Okay, this joint point, the G point is the center of gravity point. From the point only, the entire weight is acting. And due to this floating, there will be a buoyant force is developed. So the B naught is the buoyant force point. The buoyant force is concentrating a single point. That point is called buoyant force point. But this G and B naught is not always same. Okay. So from this figure, we can understand any floating body is subjected by two opposing vertical forces. Here, what are the vertical forces? One is W, that means weight of the body. Another one is the buoyant force. Okay. One is the body's weight W, which is downward, and the other is the buoyant force BF, which is upward. Okay, the weight is acting at the center of gravity G, and the buoyant force is acting at the center of buoyancy B naught. Okay, W and BF are always equal, and if these forces are collinear. Okay, so the condition is W and BF are must be equal. Okay, the body will be in upright position as in shown below. Okay, so next we have to discuss important term, that is called meta center. What is meant by meta center? Okay, so this meta center concepts mainly used in the floating bodies, especially in ship design. Okay, ship design, ship or boat design. So what is meant by meta center? So it is defined as the point above which your body starts oscillating when the body is tilted by a small angle. Okay, so now consider this is the ship. So now G point and B point both are lies in the same line. Okay, so what is M? Suppose you can draw the perpendicular line to the point B, means it will meet the G point. Okay, above the G point, that point is called M. Okay, that means M is nothing but meta center. Okay, so you draw a line first, initially it will connect both G and B, that means before tilt. Okay, in the upright position. Okay, so when the body will slightly tilt to some angle, okay, so the G point will not vary, but the B point, that buoyant force point, will vary. Now you can draw a perpendicular line. It will touch that vertical line. Before we draw that vertical line, it will meet at some point. That point is called meta center point. It is the point at which the line of action of the force of buoyancy, okay, will meet the normal axis of the body when the body is given small angular displacement. Okay, so it is the point at which line of action of the force of buoyancy, this is the line of action of the force of buoyancy, will meet the normal axis of the body when the body is given small angular displacement. So from the next slide we can easily understand. So you can see here it is stable position, okay, before tilting. Here you can see here that ship will somewhat tilt, okay, so the buoyant force point is varied, it will come from B to B dash, okay, it changes its position. Okay, now you can draw a vertical line, okay, so it will meet the normal axis, this is called a normal axis line. Okay, so this buoyant force point, through the buoyant force point draw a line, vertical line, it will meet the point somewhere in the normal axis point, so that point is called a metacenter point. Okay, so when this metacenter point will lies above the center of gravity, means it is, the ship will be stable, ship will be stable. Okay, when the metacenter point will comes below the center of gravity, means a overturning moment will happen, the ship will not stable, it will tilt in the water. Okay, so there are three conditions. First one is stable equilibrium. Stable equilibrium means if the point M, that means the metacenter point M, is above center of gravity, above G. Okay, unstable equilibrium means if the point M is below G, is below the center of gravity. Okay, so when it will come below G, so the angular displacement is more, means, okay, so the due to the wind or some wave action, the ship will be turned more, okay, tilting more means the angular displacement will more, so automatically the metacenter point will come below the center of gravity point, that means below G. So under this condition it is unstable. Next, neutral equilibrium means under this condition if the point M is at the G. So here you can see both B point and M point, both are lying in the same point. Okay, that means the buoyant force point from the upward and from the buoyant force point from the downward and weight of the fluid, sorry, weight of the ship, that means that the center of gravity point, both are meeting at the same point, means it is called a neutral equilibrium. Okay, so the metacenter height, what is mean by metacenter height, means the distance between mg, that is called a metacenter height. Okay, so the metacenter height should be always positive, okay, under stable condition. If the metacenter height is negative, means automatically the ship will be, the ship or boat will be unstable, that means it will be tilted into the water. Okay, so for the design of ship or boat, this metacenter concept is very very important, that is the application of the metacenter point. Okay, so the body may tilt from many causes. Okay, so like wind or wave action. Okay, so waves developed in sea, we know that some waves developed to some height. Okay, so this waves will strike onto the ship, means the ship will be oscillated. Okay, so and also like wind. Okay, so these two parameters influencing the tilting of the ships. Okay, this causing the center of buoyancy to shift. Okay, So under there is no wave, under there is no wind means both buoyancy point and the G point, that means center of gravity point, both lines in the normal axis. Okay, due to these two parameters, wind and wave action, this buoyancy point is shifted from normal axis. That new point, that means B dash. Here they mentioned B naught, B naught dash. I shown it below. Okay, so here you can see here M is above G. Here G is here, M is here. So this distance is called metacentric height. This is a stable position. But you can see here, G is here and M is here. So the distance is in negative. That means below the G. M comes under below the G. So this is called unstable position. Okay. So from this lecture, we discuss about Pascal's law, hydrostatic law, total pressure, center of pressure, and pressure measuring devices, and buoyancy and stability of floating bodies. So up to this, unit one is completed. Okay. Thank you. So now I will close the session.